Okay, so let me get started. So today I'd like to tell you about vector bundles and fiber bundles. So let me first remind you about tangent bundles or tangent space. Okay, so what's tangent space? Well, we have a manifold M, and at each point P of the manifold, we have a vector space, which is denoted by TP of M. And this is a vector space, so element of this space is a vector. And we can denote that in this symbol. So I give you a few different ways of understanding, interpreting this space. I think most intuitive would be to think of this manifold, to think about point that we are interested in here, and consider a smooth curve that passes through it. And this vector is literally tangent vector along this curve at this point. So that was one definition. Anyway, so you have this, suppose you have a manifold which is m-dimensional, then you have an m-dimensional vector space associated to each point. Okay, so that's a tangent vector space at this point, P. Now, since we can consider this at any point P, so we can consider collection of this vector space all over the manifold. So we can define what is called a tangent bundle. Literally, consider bundle of this vector space over the manifold. So, formally, we can write this as union of this tangent space over the manifold. So we just consider collection of all this space. This is not a direct product as a vector space, it's just collection. This is just collection of all this tangent space. Okay, but writing this is not Writing tangent bundle in this way is not very helpful. To get a better idea of this tangent bundle, I'd like to introduce coordinate on this space. So the way we can do that is the following. So how do you specify an element of this? Well, we just need two sets of data. One is to know which point we're going to choose, and at each point we can have a tangent vector space. So that means that to specify a point in this tangent bundle, what we need is a coordinate x mu for the point, and then v mu characterizing the vector at each point. So this specifies point on M, and then this v mu specifies vector in TP of M, where P must be such that XP is equal to X, namely the coordinate at point P, and the coordinate on the manifold is given by X mu. So you agree that this pair specifies element in this space. If you think about it this way, then you see that tangent bundle itself is a manifold. Tangent space is actually a special kind of manifold. So, tangent bundle is. So tangent bundle is a manifold. But it's a manifold of special kind, where coordinates are given by this pair, x and v, where x is actually coordinates on M. And v belongs to the tangent space at that point, x. So this pair gives you the coordinate. Okay? For those of you who came late, we have a special Halloween cookie over here. So, okay, so Are you happy with this? To be precise, we all want to know about, we want to need to specify the coordinate. We should also specify how coordinate transform each other as we change the coordinate. Well, in this case, in some sense, we can, this coordinate on the tangent boundary is inherited from the coordinate of the original manifold. So suppose the manifold, so we have a manifold M. And suppose you have two coordinate patches, ui and uj, that are overlapping each other. So here I have coordinate x, and here I have coordinate x tilde, for example. Okay. So then there is a transition function here. So over here, we can use both of these coordinates, and then x tilde mu has to be a function, smooth invertible function of x, and vice versa. Now, because tangent vector is given like this, v mu del del x mu, so that means that v tilde mu del del x tilde mu has to be equal to v mu of del del x mu. Right? So that means that, so I'm going to this blackboard right here. So this means that v tilde mu has to be equal to del x tilde mu del x nu v nu. So this actually gives you how these coordinates should transform each other. Namely, that we have, if you have overlapping region of the coordinate system on the manifold M, base, so this M is called base manifold when we talk about tangent bundle. This is a base. If you have this two sets of coordinates that are overlapping each other on the base, naturally, you get pair of coordinates on the tangent bundle too, x tilde, v tilde. And they are also overlapping in the sense that base are overlapping, and this tangent space over it goes along with it. And then coordinate changes are such that x tilde is this given function of x, and then v tilde, mu, is equal to del x tilde mu del x nu v nu. So this gives you a change, well-defined change of coordinate from x v to x tilde v tilde. So this defines for you tangent bundle as a manifold. Okay, that's clear? Good. So now I'm going to generalize this notion to the notion of vector bundle. So if you agree that this gives you a natural manifold out of collection of all the tangent spaces over the manifold, you realize that we do not have to do this. This definition can be generalized for other vector spaces. So namely, here I consider the case where at each point on the manifold, over each point on the manifold, we have a tangent space. But we can generalize this notion and say that at each point on the manifold, we have some vector space, not necessarily tangent space. We could also consider that. So when we consider the tangent space, we say that for each point P, we have, I realize that the colored chalks are difficult to erase. Important lesson to learn. So this is for tangent space. Similarly, we can we can generalize this notion and define what we call vector bundle. So we are considering tangent bundle before. We're going to replace tangent space by more general vector space. So, but the idea is similar. So namely, at each point P, we have some a vector space. Okay? So we would like, so for example, in the case of tangent space, what we have is locally, over each coordinate patch, the space looks like the coordinate x, the base manifold, the x is the coordinate on the base manifold, and tangent space. So locally, it looks like a direct product. So for example, over this coordinate patch ui, the tangent space is just like direct product of ui times this rn, where rn is representing this n-dimensional vector space. So we can consider the similar situation where suppose you have a coordinate patch. Ui of m, then we can consider a situation where this, what I'm going to define as a vector bundle, looks like, so let's put the name. So let's call this vector bundle as E. So then E looks like Ui tensor some vector space V. So here, in the case of tangent bundle, it looks like U times Ui times Rn, where Rn is representing the tangent vector space. Similarly, we consider more general situation where the space looks locally like, so I apologize for this blackboard, looks like Ui times V. It's not really blackboard, it's my handwriting. Ui times V. Okay? So, but I would like to express it in such a way that it's clear that over each point P, we have a vector space. So mathematicians thought about it carefully and came up with the following way to express this fact that we have a vector space over each point. So here is a definition. So E is vector bundle definition of vector bundle if it satisfies the following two properties. So one is that there is a projection map which is denoted by pi, which sends E to M, so that for each point P in M, the inverse map of this projection is isomorphic to a vector space. It looks like a complicated way of saying something very obvious, but this is a nice way of saying it if you think about it carefully. So what this means is following. Well, first of all, the second half of this statement is sort of much clearer. So what this is saying is that at each point P, we have a vector space. That vector space is a part of the manifold. So the first part of this sentence is expressing this fact. So, for example, in the case of tangent space, what is going on? Well, tangent space is locally the collection, well, the local coordinate of the tangent space is given by x and v. So, any point on the tangent space is given by this pair, coordinate and vector on the tangent space. An important point of this definition, there are two important facts about this kind of arrangement. One is that for any element of this tangent bundle, we know where the point on the manifold that tangent vector is sitting on. So you have a manifold, and at each point of the manifold, we have this tangent vector space, and then we are choosing particular vector on that tangent vector space, right? So if any element of this tangent bundle is associated to a particular point on the manifold, and so this projection map is telling you where that point is. Okay? And once you know the point that you are interested in, then I would like to express the fact that you have a vector space over that point. At each point on the manifold, there's a vector space associated with it. So the second part of this sentence is expressing this fact. Okay? So if you think about it, this is a very nice way to say it, although look like, it sounds like it's said in a rather complicated way, but if you think about it, this is actually a very nice way of saying it. And the second point is that again, in the case of tangent bundle, there is a natural choice of coordinate on the tangent bundle, naturally associated to the coordinate of the base manifold, so that you have a pair of each coordinate is a pair. X represents a coordinate on the base, and V represents a coordinate on the fiber. And then base transforms like coordinate transformation, and fiber transforms like that. Sorry. The tangent vector transforms like this over here. So we'd like to have generalization of this notion. So how do we do that? Well, so that means that we can choose an atlas of E. Remember, atlas is just a collection of coordinate charts. So we can choose collection of coordinate of E. Remember, E is a manifold itself. So we can choose coordinate of E to have a similar kind of thing. So what it means is that each coordinate looks like a pair, that one of which is the coordinate of the original manifold, and the other one represents element of the vector space. So that for each local coordinate, that U, there is a the coordinate of E is given by this pair, namely that X and V, where, so I'm going to the second blackboard, where X is a coordinate over U, and V is just element of this vector space that we have chosen. Okay. So locally, again, it looks like a product space. So it looks like you have vector bundle. So over each point P of the manifold, we have a vector bundle. Another point P prime, we have another vector bundle. Vector space. And yet over another point P, we have yet another vector space. So these vector spaces are all isomorphic to each other. So that's a vector bundle. So it's a bundle of these vector spaces over the manifold.
Where does it say that all the vector spaces must be isomorphic?
That's a definition. You can generalize, so this is a part of the definition of vector bundle. When we say vector bundle, all the vectors spaces over points on the manifold has to be isomorphic. Okay. You can consider generalization of this notion, but that's more advanced concept that we are not going to discuss in this lecture. So it's a part of the definition. Okay. Now this vector space, so over each point P, you have vector space which is isomorphic to V. They all say isomorphic to the same vector space. And this vector space over this point P is called fiber over P. It's called fiber. So it looks like, well, this is sort of trying to express that pictorially. Over this manifold M, we have these fibers. And each fiber, in this case, is a vector space. Okay? So here, for example, we are considering finite dimensional vector space. We can consider vector space to be with real coefficient. Well, we can consider vector space with complex coefficient. We can consider quaternionic vector space and all these kind of things. And so when we have vector space V is a vector space with real coefficient, we call the bundle as real vector bundle. We can consider complex vector bundle where the vector space over each point, the fiber over each point, is a complex vector space with complex coefficient. In particular, when you have a fiber which is complex one-dimensional, we call that as line bundle, because over each point you have just a line. So in that case, we call that as a line bundle. Line bundle is a case when complex dimension of the vector space is 1. So this is a special case, but this often appears, so it's useful terminology to know.
Now,
hi, dozo. He was asking, in order to define complex vector bundle, whether it is necessary that the base manifold is a complex manifold. Okay. Let me think about that. If you want the vector bundle to be complex manifold, clearly the base manifold has to be also complex manifold. Now, when I wrote this note, I was not careful to actually double check to see whether the terminology is such that complex vector bundle require base manifold to be complex manifold. Now you tell me, I think that that's probably the case, so maybe I was a little bit careless to say that it's sufficient to say that each fiber is complex valued, vector space with complex coefficient. I guess it's natural to say that when we have a complex vector bundle E, the E has to be itself has to be complex manifold, in which case a base manifold should be complex manifold. I guess you are mass major, so you should know.
No, I mean, you always talk about the complexified tangent bundle or spinner bundle. Ah,
okay, that's
you
true.
You don't need a complex
we can, for example, consider line bundle over odd dimensional manifold, for example.
You don't need a
yeah, bundle. That's right. Thank you. So, the answer is, I think, I'll double check on that, because it's a matter of terminology, so I cannot derive it from first principles, I cannot do it on the top of my head. But I think it's probably the case, I'll double check that, but I think that it's not necessary. I think that's probably true. Because I think we can consider line bundle over, for example, odd dimensional space, but I'll double check on that. Thank you for asking.
Wait, but to end up with complex vector spaces, you would need a complex manifold without?
You don't need it because if you consider tangent bundle, then, for example, structure of the base and the structure of fibers are tied to each other. But it's not the case here because you define vector space independently of the structure of the base.
Oh, I see. So you can just have complex vector fields if you feel like it?
Right, yeah, you can have complex vector space,
space
over
yeah.
Real manifold, for example, I think.
Okay.
Well, you can certainly consider that how do you call it is a matter of notation, so I cannot really say that, but I think that's true. Now I have to talk about how, so in the case of tangent bundle, the way that base coordinate transforms each other, coordinate of the base manifold transforms each other, tells you how the coordinate on the fiber transforms into each other. But in more general vector bundle, we have to specify that information independently. So here is what we do. So suppose, again, we have a manifold M where you have overlapping coordinate patch ui, uj. Okay, so then locally, look like we have x and v, x tilde, v tilde, So X and V is a coordinate over UI, and X, so for example, X is a coordinate of the base UI, and X tilde is a coordinate over UJ, for example. We have this. And X tilde is, of course, a function of X. In the case of differentiable manifold, it's a smooth function. If it is a complex manifold, it has to be a holomorphic function. But then we have to also specify how the fiber coordinate transforms each other. In the case of a tangent vector space, remember, so in the case of a tangent bundle, so the way it went was that we have V tilde of mu, which is equal to del X tilde of mu, del X nu, times V nu. So it is a linear transformation of D to V tilde with coefficient which depends on the position. So I say that we do the same thing here, namely that V tilde, now it is a more general vector, element of more general vector space, should be obtained by some kind of linear transformation of V, whose coefficient depends on X in general, where G of X, therefore, is an element of GL N R, in the case of a real vector bundle, where N is a dimension of this vector space. Okay? So we're going to change the base coordinate just like we do in the standard differentiable manifold, but the fiber coordinate transforms linearly like this. Now, so this is a natural thing to do, but we have to be careful about one thing, that it turns out that it is not always possible to choose this G of X arbitrarily. There are constraints. And then it is known that it is necessary in order to define vector bundle consistently, it is necessary and sufficient to satisfy the following condition. Let's choose three coordinate patch, UI, UJ, UK. And suppose that these three coordinate patches are overlapping with each other. Then you say that, for example, if we want to compare coordinate UI and UK, there are two different ways of doing it. One is that just to go from this coordinate UI to UK directly. So that means that, well, suppose, for example, the coordinate here is XI, VI. Here you have XJ, VJ. Here you have XK, VK. Then on this overlapping region, VK is given by some kind of transformation. Let's write it as KI of X. VI. I have to be a little bit careful to say that these indices are not supposed to be summed over, but this is just telling you which coordinate patch that I'm choosing. So we have to have this kind of relation. But then there's another way of doing it, is that to start from here, first go to this coordinate patch over here, and then go to this coordinate patch. So namely, so far the way we get is that VK is equal to VKJ of X, BJ, by using transition function here. Oh, by the way, this V tilde, G of X is called a transition function, I should have said. This is a matrix, but it's a function, because it in general depends on the position, and it tells you how to transit from one coordinate to another, so it's called transition function. So VJ is equal to transition function times VI, so that means that it is equal to GKJ, GJI, both depend on X, times VI. So there are two different ways of going from here to here. They have to be compatible because in order for the coordinate system to be consistent, the way that coordinates should transform into each other should not depend on how you do it. So that means that we have to have the condition that this combination of transition function is equal to this one. So we have this kind of consistency condition that GKI is equal to GKJ GJI. So this is called the co-cycle condition. This is a consistency condition for the coordinate transformation of a vector bundle. In the case of tangent bundle, you can easily check by yourself that this co-cycle condition is satisfied. Let me just double check on that. In the case of tangent bundle, this G would be something like del x tilde del x. That was, so if you want to write the indices explicitly, it's like that. So suppose you go, you have three coordinate patches that are overlapping with each other. Then you may consider G tilde tilde going to G tilde, and then multiply G tilde over del of G tilde over del x. But then you know that by the composition rule of the differentiation, it is equal to del x tilde tilde over del x. So the co-cycle condition is satisfied automatically by this standard relation of differentiation. Okay. But in general, if you consider more general vector bundle, then it's not guaranteed that this is satisfied. So this has to be independently required. It is known that if this co-cycle condition is satisfied, then we can consistently introduce coordinate. Yes?
Is that what check?
Any question?
Yes. Is that what check homology measures? Is when that co-cycle doesn't?
I cannot hear you. Could you speak up?
If a co-cycle does not exist, right, is check cohomology the thing measuring how much it fails?
It's a condition for absence of co-cycle. I have not explained check cohomology or co-cycle, so I think it's not appropriate to discuss that. But here I'm just introducing this as sort of terminology. I could have just called it as consistency condition, but if you look at some of the literature on geometry, often this is referred to as co-cycle condition, so it's useful to remember this as, know this as a co-cycle condition. Okay.
So are you saying that this set of conditions, or this set of maps is consistent if and only if that holds, or that...
Yeah, so more precise way of saying is that if you have a differential manifold M, and if you have a set of transition function G over that manifold satisfying this co-cycle condition, then there is a unique fiber bundle. This transition function defines a fiber bundle.
Yes.
Just like in the case of manifold, if you know coordinate patch and how they transform each other, then we know that that defines a manifold, right? So namely, the manifold is defined by sets of coordinates and how they transform each other. So therefore, if you know the base manifold M, and if you give me transition function that satisfies this condition, then it is known that it gives you unique fiber bundle, a vector bundle in this case. Okay? Now, I'm going to go one step farther and define yet more general object, that's fiber bundle. So here we consider vector bundle where over each point P of the manifold M, we have this vector bundle, vector space V. We can consider more general structure where over each point P of the manifold M, we have some stuff, something. So that, well, it has to have some structure. So it has, it can be some group element or some, it, that itself may be manifold, for example. But it can be any of such geometric object. So that's called fiber bundle. Like I said, so in the previous case, the vector space at each point was called a fiber. So we are sort of collecting those fibers. And here we are saying that fiber does not necessarily have to be a vector space. It can be something more general. But otherwise, the structure is the same. So we have fiber bundle E. And the fiber bundle has to have this structure that we have a projection pi, which maps E into the manifold M. This is a base manifold. So that over each point P of this manifold, the inverse image of the of this point P, inverse image of the projection of this inverse image of this point P by this projection is isomorphic to some space F, which I called fiber. But when we talk about fiber bundle, this space all has to be isomorphic. We can consider more general things where they can, it can depend on the position, but that's more sort of abstract, so I'm not going to discuss that. So here I assume that all the fiber look alike. Okay. So that's a fiber bundle. So locally, again, if you choose local coordinate touch U of this base, then the total space locally look like product of this U times the fiber. But again, as we change coordinate, they should transform appropriately. In the case of vector bundle, it was natural to say that fiber transforms as a linear transformation like that. So let me give you an example of a fiber bundle which is different from the vector bundle. For example, we can choose F to be G, where G is some continuous group. For example, SO3. Doesn't have to be SO3, but SO3 is an example of a continuous group.
What does it mean to be a continuous group?
Continuous group is, well, one way to say continuous group is a continuous group is a group that is a differentiable manifold. So for example, there are discrete groups which just consist of points, right? So for example, Z2 consists of two elements, one and another element which square to be one. So that's not a manifold. But this, so but on the other hand, SO3 is a manifold because we can parameterize SO3 by Euler angle, for example, as you might have learned in classical mechanics course. So this kind of group, so the continuous group is a group with this kind of smooth structure to it. So we can choose F to be, yes, you have a question.
Yeah, do we have any second condition that would give us differential structure fiber bundle?
Yeah, I wasn't too specific about what fiber is. So fiber itself should be some kind of manifold.
Right.
And we also have to have some kind of consistency condition for the transition function, clearly.
Yes.
So we can have this continuous group, for example. In that case, when you change coordinate, then the change of coordinate is not done by this kind of linear transformation, but done by multiplication of another group element. So what it means is that, for example, in the case of a continuous group, local coordinate can be chosen like pair of x mu and group element g. Or I guess I shouldn't use g because I used g for the transition function. So let me call that as rho. So x mu represents a position on the base manifold M, and rho is an element of G. we can have another set of coordinates, x tilde of mu, rho tilde. And if the base coordinate patch overlap with each other, there is a transition function from x to x tilde. Similarly, we need to know how rho transforms. So we can say rho tilde is g of x times rho, for example, where g of x is an element of continuous group that depends on position in general. Okay? Now, if you look at this definition of, so we can consider this kind of vector bundle whose fiber is a group, and such kind of fiber bundle in particular is called a principal bundle. It's called a principal bundle because it plays a principal role, because it's important. And the reason it's important is that, for example, you can control the structure of vector bundle by principal bundle. Because, for example, if I come to this part of the blackboard, you see that when you change, suppose you have a vector bundle, when you change coordinate x to x tilde and v to v tilde, transition function g for the fiber is an element of the group, right? So, in some sense, if you have a vector bundle over each transition, over each overlapping coordinate, we have transition function which is expressed by group element. So then, for such vector bundle, there is actually natural principal bundle. We can just use that g tilde, g over here. So that's called associated. Principal bundle. Conversely, if you have principal bundle, then we can use that to define vector bundle. So of course, from that you can guess that this g of x transition function has to also satisfy co-cycle conditions. So there's a tight connection between principal bundle and the vector bundle.
Wait, I don't get it. If you do that, won't the elements of the fiber here be the transition maps over in the vector space?
No, element of fiber is not. Because you see that here, so it's the same G over here and over here.
But over there, G was taking vectors, so how could it possibly take group elements over here?
Well, group multiply with each other. So for example, let's take this G to be GLN.
Okay.
So then GLN, so rho is an element of GLN. So we can multiply element of GLN to it. That's one of the property of the group.
Oh, okay.
Okay? All right, yes, please.
So to turn a principal bundle into a vector bundle, we need a representation of the group? Or?
That's right, yeah, so that's right. So here I just chose the fundamental representation. So the interesting thing about fiber, I did not want to go into, because I'm not sure whether everybody is familiar with the representation of group theory or not. But if you know that, what I can say is that if you have principal bundle, for each representation of the group G, we can define vector bundle. Right? Because you just need to choose this vector space to be representation of that group. You can choose different representation for each of them. This naturally defines for you vector bundle. So that means that one principal bundle can give you whole lot different vector bundles for each representation. So for all of these vector bundles, the structure is controlled by the principal bundle. So that's why it's called the principal bundle. Thank you for raising this point. This was an important point. Okay, so let me give you an example of fiber bundle. in fact, it's an example of principal bundle. So, principal bundle whose fiber is group U1. So U1 principal bundle. Over two-dimensional sphere. I'd like to remind you that U1 is a group whose element is the complex number of unit module. So the absolute value is equal to 1. So I choose theta to be real number. And if you multiply these two, two of such numbers, then of course it's still unit module, unit length. So it's a group. So it's called U1. Okay? So this theta, you can choose to be between 0 and 2 pi. So we can parameterize U1 in this way. So U1 itself is a group. So when we talk about principal U1 bundle, U1 principal bundle, what we mean is that we choose F, the fiber, to be this group. So in particular, we can use theta as a coordinate of this group. Okay, so S2 is a two-sphere. So over two-sphere, we have, at each point over two-sphere, we have this group sitting. Okay. So now, in this case, I can present for you various principal bundle. And these principal bundles that I'm going to present for you are parameterized by an integer. So here is a construction. So you have two sphere. Remember that it's not possible to cover the entire two sphere by one coordinate patch. That's not possible. So however we can do is divide this space into upper hemisphere and lower hemisphere, and we choose the first coordinate patch to be covering the northern hemisphere going slightly over the equator. And then we can choose the second coordinate patch to be covering southern hemisphere going slightly over the equator. So that these two coordinate patches overlap with each other over the equator and then cover the two sphere entirely. So we have such coordinates. So we can choose appropriate coordinate. One natural way to choose that coordinate is that if you have northern hemisphere, we have North Pole. We can choose, so suppose we want to know we want to specify coordinate here. What we do is choose some kind of meridian over here. And then we first decide about this coordinate phi, angle phi. And then we also measure the distance of this point from the North Pole and call that as R. And then this combination, phi and R, specifies a position, specify a point on the North Pole. So we can use that as a nice coordinate. So we can choose R and phi as coordinate on the North Pole. So to specify that it is a North Pole, a northern hemisphere coordinate, we call that as R plus and phi. We can also choose R minus and phi for southern hemisphere. So this is for the northern hemisphere. Southern hemisphere. I have chosen this angle so that these angles coincide over the equator. Okay. So this, you agree that this gives you a nice set of coordinates to parameterize position on the two sphere, right? Now I have to tell you how we match the fiber coordinate. So over this northern hemisphere, we have this coordinate R and theta, phi. And over this point, we have a fiber. So we have a fiber, which is like a circle, parameterized by theta. So we have three sets of three coordinates, r plus, in this case, phi and theta. And for southern hemisphere, you also have something like that. So let's call that as theta plus. So we need to know how r plus phi e to the I theta plus and r minus phi and e to the I theta minus transform into each other. Okay, so I'm going to give you actually a nice class of such transition function. So I'm going to declare that the following is a nice set of transition function. E to the I theta minus is equal to E to the I n phi times E to the I theta plus. So this is the coordinate on the fiber. This is an element of U1. And I say that this element of U1 and this element of U1 is related by this twist. So what this is doing is the following. Suppose n is 0, so I choose n to be integer. I need that in order for this to be periodic. So what it does is the following. So suppose n is 0. In that case, we have a trivial space because the northern coordinate in the northern hemisphere, the coordinate of the fiber in the northern hemisphere, and the coordinate in the coordinate for the fiber in the southern hemisphere agrees. So the totally the space is just S2 times U1. So if n is zero, then the total space is just S2 times U1. So in this case, we have a trivial bundle. We call that as trivial because it's just a trivial tensor product. So how about n equal 1? Well, we have a little bit more interesting space. Because what happens is that as you go around the equator, these two are not identified anymore, but identified with rotation. And this rotation, we have one rotation, 2 pi rotation, as you go around the equator. So it's a non-trivial patching of the two coordinates. So you get some non-trivial bundle. For each integer, you have non-trivial bundles, except non-trivial bundle, except in the case of n equals 0. This fiber bundle is known as monopole bundle. The reason for that is the following. So I'm going to tell you, explain you later about the relation between vector bundle and the gauge theory. But here, for example, this kind of vector bundle specifies for you the structure of U1 gauge theory, namely Maxwell theory on two spheres. And if you have Maxwell theory in 3 plus 1 dimensional space, in that Maxwell theory, you can consider a configuration of Maxwell field corresponding to point charge located, say, for example, at the origin. And that point charge can be electric or magnetic. And in particular, if you put monopole, magnetic monopole charge at the origin, it induces some configuration of electromagnetic field. And in particular, you can ask what's the configuration of electromagnetic field on two spheres surrounding this point. Turns out that Maxwell field is characterized by this vector bundle with integer n. So it's called the monopole bundle. Okay, so in particular, the monopole bundle with unit charge n equal 1 is interesting because we can show that in this case, the bundle is isomorphic to three spheres. Namely, this shows that three sphere can be thought of as U1 vector, U1 bundle, and U1 is like S1. So U1 bundle over S2. So this shows that S3 is U1 bundle over S2 with n equal 1. This particular bundle is called Hopf bundle. For the reason that I'm going to explain. Hopf bundle or Hopf vibration. So let me explain why this is the case, why S3 can be expressed as U1 bundle over S2. So I'm going to show that explicitly. So this is actually the way that Hopf did. So S3, you can think of it in various different ways, but one way of thinking about three-dimensional sphere is a collection of points in R4 with unit distance from the origin. So S3 can be regarded as a solution to this equation. So A, B, C, D are some real numbers. So this is S3, right? So then, what I want to do is first, well, in order to say that this is a vector bundle, this is a U1 bundle, we need to exhibit the fiber bundle structure. So what we need for the fiber bundle, first of all, is a projection map from S3 to S2. So that its inverse image is U1. Right? So I'm going to exhibit that. So the way that Hopf did is to write down this projection map explicitly. So I'm going to say x is equal to a square plus b square minus c square minus d square. Y is twice ad plus bc. And z is twice bd minus ac. You can check, this is a simple algebra, to check that x squared plus y squared plus z squared is 1. So you see that this gives you a map from 3 sphere to 2 sphere. So it's a projection map. So the remaining task is to figure out what the fiber is. If the fiber is U1, then this is showing that S3 is a U1 bundle over S2. So that's my first question. Show the inverse image of a point P is isomorphic to U1. Okay, so I'm going to give you a very nice hint so you can easily figure out why this is. So I'm going to give you a hint. Yes? Somebody asked a question? Okay. The hint is following. So let's introduce complex combination A plus IB and C minus IB. So I'm going to combine these four real numbers into two complex numbers. So then the fact that you have S3 is just UU bar plus VV bar is equal to 1. So you can write this equation in this way. So projection map can be written also as X is equal to UU bar minus VV bar. And z plus iy to be equal to twice of u v bar. If you write it in this way, then, and if you think about it a little bit, then I hope it's evident to you that inverse image of this pi should be u1. Think about it. Okay? So that's my first question. This class of fiber bundle is called Hopf fibration because Hopf Well, around that time, it was very important question to classify map between manifold. Well, it's also an important question now. But in fact, it turns out that in order to classify, in order to understand topological features of a map from manifold to another manifold, important example to understand was a map from sphere of some dimension to sphere of another dimension. And so this was sort of one of the first examples to think about. And Hopp came up with very sort of surprising, at that time, example of a map like that. So that's why it's called Hopp vibration. Okay? So now I would like to, so this is a question, so I want you to figure this out. So these are about fiber bundles, and now I would like to discuss connections and curvature of vector bundles and principal bundles. So remember that in a couple of lectures ago, we discussed the issue of taking derivative of tangent vectors. That, yes, you have a question.
Why do you require the fibers to have a manifold structure?
Because I require it. The nice thing about the mathematics is that you don't have to explain yourself. This is a definition. The merit has to be decided by usefulness. Some definitions are useless, and other definitions are useful.
Well, fair enough.
Other than that, I don't have to explain myself. And the reason that I would like it to be manifold is that in physics, we would like to write down differential equations. To do that, it has to be a manifold.
Okay, but vector spaces are, how are they manifolds?
Vector space is a manifold because vector space is an element of Rn, and Rn is a manifold. Okay, so we are talking about taking derivative of tangent space, a tangent vector field, and we had difficulty, remember. So the reason that we couldn't do that was that to define derivative, say for example function, what we needed to do was to compare two different points. Well, let's see. So for example, if I just want to have, say, one dimensional function on one dimensional variable, then this is defined as the limit of y goes to x, y minus x of fx, fy minus fx. This is a definition of derivative. In order for us to be able to do that, we need to be able to compare these two things and take a difference. We could do that if f is a function taking value in real number. But if it's taking value in tangent space, for example, then if you have two different points, you have to be able to take difference of tangent vector at two different points, and a priori there is no way of doing it. And one way of doing it was to introduce affine connection. Now, I would like to give you a more general framework to think about this kind of question. And that leads to the notion of connection. Okay? So what we should do in order to take derivative? Well, suppose you have a manifold M, and suppose you have a point P, and point P tilde, two points. Well, more generally, suppose you have a curve, C of T, parameterized by some real number. So it's some kind of curve. So you have a manifold M, and then suppose you have a curve C of T. Okay? So at each point, C of T, we have, say, for example, the tangent space. Well, let's still stick to the tangent space. So then we can, at each point, C of T, we have a tangent vector space. For different value of t, you have different spaces. We cannot compare. So what we need to do is to define a way to compare, say, t of c of 0 of m to t of c of t of m. So we need some kind of linear map between them. So I'm just going to introduce such linear map and denote that as omega of t. So what we say is that we have a manifold m, and then we have some kind of curve c of t along this manifold. Here you have some particular point, 0. Here you have another point. We need to be able to transport a vector here to a vector here. We need to be able to identify vector here and vector here. Well, fortunately, this is a linear space, so we can imagine that there is a linear map between them. So what we can do is the following. If there is a way of identifying this vector space and vector space by some linear transformation, then we can define derivative of a vector along this curve by just considering this. Namely, you choose, so this is a coordinate x for the parameter t. This is a coordinate x at parameter t equals 0. We cannot directly compare them, but we can compare them if we bring this vector sitting over here to a vector sitting over here by this linear transformation. And after that, we can compare, so therefore we can take the difference and then take derivative.
How will you take the limit?
Limit? Where am I taking the limit?
There's a limit in the derivative.
Oh, okay, so if we want to define limit, well, so for example, I could do this. Plus epsilon. Well, so if you want me to write the derivative in as a limit, I could also do it like this. Dt v. So maybe let's not just try to be general and just evaluate it at t equals 0. If you want me to do it, then I can define it like this. So this is the definition of a derivative. So you see that this belongs to tangent space at x epsilon. This belongs to tangent space at x equals 0, at x with t equals 0. But then, so in principle, we cannot compare these two, but we can compare them if we transport.
Are you saying that you'll get the same definition of derivative no matter how you take a metric from R and?
No, I'm not introducing a metric, but I'm introducing this new concept, omega. Mm-hmm. So this definition depends on this choice of omega. So this is going to give you the connection. For the purpose of definition of derivative, it's sufficient to know this omega for infinitesimal value of epsilon. And we just need to define that for each curve. So you see that it's natural to think of this infinitesimal version of this transport as a one-form, because one-form is a dual to the tangent vector, which is sort of infinitesimal version of a smooth curve. So that leads to the following definition that we have seen that the derivative mu of v of alpha is going to be equal to del mu of v of alpha plus a mu alpha beta of v beta. This is an this is another way of expressing this type of definition. So this A represents nothing but infinitesimal version of this transformation between two different fibers. So if you think about this, then you see that we can define this for any vector bundle. As far as we can introduce this kind of concept, the connection, we can define derivative operator for any vector bundle. Now, this vector, this connection has to behave in such a way that under change of coordinate of the fiber bundle or vector bundle, this object should transform nicely. So this leads to the following requirement. So suppose we make a change of coordinate. So for example, we can have coordinate x and v. So where this x is related is a coordinate for the base m, and v is a coordinate for the fiber v. Suppose this transforms like this. Suppose we do the coordinate change so that base coordinate do not change, but only the fiber coordinate changes. We would like v mu of the del mu of v to transform like one form with respect to the coordinate, but transform like this for the fiber. The consistency, so we'd like del mu of g of x v to be equal to g of x del mu of v. This requires A to transform in appropriate fashion. We can show that this requires that A to transform into g inverse ag minus g inverse del mu of g. So if A transforms in this way, then this transforms nicely under this coordinate transformation. So the transformation property of the connection is determined by this kind of consistency. So this A, which you can think of this as one form, is a matrix valued one form. The one form whose entries are matrices, and then it transforms like A goes to G inverse AG minus G inverse D, G, so that this covariant derivative transforms nicely under coordinate transformation. Now I'd like to introduce a notion of holonomy to characterize connection. Holonomy is the following notion. So here, I assumed that if you have a smooth curve on the manifold, we can parallel transform the vector of the vector bundle along this smooth curve. Connection is an infinitesimal version of that. Now, suppose we have a curve on M, but it starts with point P, go around. the manifold and come back to the same point P. Well, what happens to the vector that you parallel transport? It is not guaranteed that you come back to the same vector. In general, if you have, so let's call this closed path as gamma. So then, for along this closed path, if you parallel transform vector along this closed path, the vector v would transform into omega xi of v, and this omega xi does not have to be an identity matrix. This omega is called holonomy of this path. Important aspect of the holonomy is that it makes a group. So holonomy make a group. And we can see group structure can be seen in the following way. So suppose I pick a point P. Suppose we have a closed path, which I call C1. Then for that, I can define omega of xi. Suppose you have another closed path and call that as xi2, then we have omega of xi2. Now we can consider combination of these two closed paths. What I mean is that I start with this xi1, once come back to the point P, but then I decide that I want to do one more tour, so I'm going to go around xi2 and come back to the same point. We can call that as xi3. So that's a combination of xi1 and xi2. It's easy to see that omega of xi3 is omega of xi2 times omega of xi1. Because you go around omega xi1, parallel transport the vector, that vector is multiplied by omega of xi1. You decide to go around xi2, you get another omega. So that's what you get. So you have a group structure. You can also see that if you decide to go around xi1, but then change your mind and go back up, come back to the same point, then in that case, you should get an identity. So therefore, you have an inverse operation, which corresponds to going backward along the closed path. So the collection of holonomy at each point P makes a group. Now, you may think that this definition of holonomy group depends on the choice of the point. But it's not, the choice of point is actually not an important thing. So, yes, you have a question?
A quick question. From the drawing you did, it looked like that group would be commutative, the multiplication. Is that always true?
Why you say that?
If you go around a P by a path.
Okay, so let's see. So I'm sorry I erased it, so let me try that.
It just looks like it wouldn't matter whether you went around C1 first and then C2 versus C2 and then C1.
Why do you say that?
Because you return to the same point P.
Yes.
It looks like you would start the path in a sense. So I'm asking if that's true.
That's not true.
It looks to me to be true.
It's not clear to me why it has to be the case. Because if you go around this point, around this C1, you get omega of C1 times V. After that, you may decide to go around C2. You have this. If you do it the other way, you get the other order. And a priori, well, that was what you were saying. That you're saying that from this argument, they should commute?
No. I wasn't thinking about the action on P. I was thinking about just traversing.
But these are matrices, and a priori, they do not have to be commuting with each other. Now, so the question I was trying to pose to you is the following. So, Q2. Suppose M is connected so that you can go from one point to another point on the manifold along a smooth curve. Then I would like to show you that holonomy group. At P is isomorphic to holonomy group at another point P tilde. You define holonomy group at point P, you define holonomy group at point P tilde. I'd like you to see that they are related to each other. I give you a hint. So suppose you have a close the path like that, then you can consider this kind of curve. Then you can regard that as a closed path. Start, so suppose you have this is a point of P tilde, and suppose this is P. By adding this neck, you can think of closed path around starting and ending at P tilde as closed path starting and ending at P, vice versa. And then, so you can therefore rewrite element over here to an element over here, and vice versa. And using these kind of things, you can actually show that these two are isomorphic. So that's a question. So the reason that there are a couple of reasons that I'm bringing in this notion of holonomy. One is that in the case of affine connection, in the case of Riemannian geometry, in addition to the affine connection, I introduced a notion of curvature. Curvature is closely related to the notion of holonomy, and in fact, it is a sort of infinitesimal version of holonomy. So, namely, the following. Suppose we consider this particular infinitesimal path, where I decide to go to the direction of V, infinitesimal direction in V, namely, you go from x mu to epsilon times V mu first. So this is x, and this is x plus epsilon V. And then you go to some other direction, U, so x plus epsilon V plus epsilon tilde of U. U and V are some tangent vector at point x. And then decide to come back to a point x plus epsilon tilde of U, and then go down like that. This is a closed path. This is a closed path. But suppose epsilon and epsilon tilde are infinitesimal. In that case, you can show that this omega, this holonomy are associated to this parallelogram, excuse me. Omega associated to this parallelogram is equal to identity plus epsilon times epsilon tilde times B mu, U mu, U nu times F mu nu.
Why are you seemingly assuming that M has a manifold or a vector space structure where you can add?
Oh, M is not a vector space, but I'm adding coordinates. These coordinates are element of Rm.
Okay.
So we can add and subtract.
Okay.
So this F mu nu is actually commutator of this covariant derivative, namely V mu del nu minus del nu del mu. Or if I write it in the notation of the differential form, then this is equal to dA plus A with A. This is called curvature of this connection. F is called curvature. In the case of Riemannian manifold, in the case when A is affine connection, then this is nothing but the Riemann curvature. This is a generalization of the notion of Riemann curvature. Now, in general, holonomy for vector van der V is an element of GLN R, where N is a dimension of the final vector V. So in general, holonomy is an element of general linear transformation because it transforms the fiber. Omega acts on the fiber, so it should be an element of GLN R. So it's some kind of subgroup of general linear group. But if you have a special type of connection, naturally holonomy has to be subgroup of some restricted class of group. So for example, if you have affine connection, of a Riemannian manifold, in that case, important feature of the affine connection is that it preserves a metric. It preserves the inner product structure. So in that case, this holonomy group, let me call this as capital G, this holonomy group has to be subgroup of ON. Because it has to preserve the length. So it's a subgroup of ON. Suppose we have complex manifold, or let's consider K-Lar manifold. And then suppose the dimension is 2m, because it's a complex manifold, so it has to have an even dimension. In that case, holonomy is a subgroup of UM. Because we should be able to choose the tangent space coordinate to be in the complex combination, and the coordinate transformation is done holomorphically. So, but still preserve the inner product structure because the complex structure is compatible with the metric structure in the case of K-Lar manifold. So that leaves us to subgroup UM. If you have a Carabiar manifold, then holonomy group is subgroup of SUM. Carabiar manifold is a manifold with vanishing rich curvature. Somehow rich tensor represents the U1 part, U1 subgroup, diagonal U1 subgroup of UM. So if it is a Carabiar manifold, its holonomy is a subgroup of SUM. So holonomy basically knows about structure of the connection. Connection is an infinitesimal version of parallel transportation. And if you know connection, well, you can do infinitesimal transportation. You can repeat that to find out how the parallel transportation is done. And holonomy contains the data of what happens if you go back to the same point. Infinitesimal version of the holonomy is a curvature. However, even if the curvature is zero, it's not necessarily the case that the holonomy is trivial. Because, for example, you can imagine a situation where you are on the torus, the surface of a donut. Suppose if you knew the field strength or the curvature is equal to zero, so that means that if you have a cycle like that, then the holonomy associated to this cycle is trivial because you can shrink to a point because if mu nu is zero. However, if you have a cycle like that, then the holonomy along this cycle is not necessarily trivial. So if curvature is zero, even if the curvature is zero, holonomy is not necessarily trivial. So there is just this is just a word, but when f mu nu is equal to zero, the holonomy is not necessarily trivial, And in that case, actually, the holonomy is called monodromy. When f mu nu is zero, then the connection satisfying this condition is called flat connection. So, flat connection. So this is just a terminology, but holonomy for flat connection is called monodromy. Okay, so I hope by now it should be clear to most of you, but I just wanted to make the final point, that is that the connection of the vector bundle we have been talking about today, is naturally related to concept in gauge theory. Where a mu can be identified as a vector potential, and f mu nu, which is equal to del mu a nu minus del nu a nu. And in the case when a mu do not commute with each other, we have to add a mu a nu. So this corresponds to field strength. So for example, in the case of Maxwell theory, the group is U1. In that case, this commutator term is zero because U1 element commute with each other. So in that case, this is just but nothing but the electromagnetic field strength. And A mu is just a scalar and a vector potential, depending whether mu is in time direction or space direction. So we see that the vector bundle and connection on it gives you a natural framework to think about gauge field in a mathematical way. So that's my lecture today. Next lecture, I'm going to go back and in the beginning of this lecture, I introduced a notion of manifold. There, I skipped the definition of topological space. So I would like to come back and discuss that concept and also introduce a notion of homology, a sort of object that is dual to cohomology. So that's for next week. Thank you.